Principal, ladies and gentlemen, it's a pleasure to introduce this evening's inaugural lecture. Hemant Kocher was born in Jodhpur in Rajasthan, India, and graduated from the Seth GS Medical College in Mumbai. He continued his surgical training at the King Edward VII Memorial Hospital in Mumbai before coming to London to pursue a career as a surgeon scientist. After completing his scientific training with Professors Hendry and Benjamin and his specialist training in HBB surgery with Professors Benjamin, Heaton, Reeler and Patel, he was awarded the prestigious NIHR Clinician Scientist Fellowship to establish his group here at Barts Cancer Institute under the mentorship of Professor Ian Hart. The research interests that he's pursued here include pancreatic tumour stromal biology, clinical trials, biobanking, surgical techniques, epidemiology, and risk stratification related to liver and pancreatic disease. A true Renaissance man. He was promoted in recognition of his contributions in all domains to a readership in 2011, and then at the end of last year, he was recognized for a full professorship here at the Barts Cancer Institute. He's won many awards and prizes, including the Cutlass Fellowship in 2007, the GlaxoSmithKline Young Fellow Award, the Royal Society of Medicine in 2006, and a travelling fellowship from the Royal College of Surgeons in Glasgow. He holds many senior leadership roles, both academic and clinical, including being the director of the National Pancreas Registry and Tissue Bank, the director of the Pancreas Tissue Bank here, being the MDT lead for hepatobiliary and pancreatic cancer at Barts Health, the largest trust in the country, and senior roles with many societies and charities. I call Hemant to the podium to give his lecture on precision and equipoise for a surgeon scientist.
It's so nice to see all of you here. Thank you very much for coming on the election night. There are many surgeons in the audience, and they all know we have been trained to be precise, to be quick and deliberate in our actions. We do this so that we can engender confidence and trust among our patients and our clinical staff. And just like all the scientists in this audience, we have to maintain equipoise. We have to question our data. And this is what I'm going to talk about. How do you combine these diverse philosophies where, in one hand, you have to say can and must, and on the other hand, you say maybe. But first of all, my journey. And my journey is through diverse landscapes, not only geographical or climatic, but also socioeconomic and cultural. My mother and father came from Rajasthan. My mother still does not understand why her grandchildren in London call a sunny day a good day. Why they wrinkle their nose when it is raining. At her house, when it is raining, it's celebration. We have a party. And if it rains the whole day, the next day the schools are off. Rajasthan is the land of kings, land of princely states, land of forts and palaces, temples. There are many kings, princesses, warriors, and tradesmen. And this is a place where you will see a person with a Chinese nose, perhaps, blue eyes, and a brown skin, all hallmarks of tradesmen who have been there. So in this land, there's a lot of color, because the landscape is very stark. It's vibrant. The handicrafts are exquisite. And the cuisine, it's fabulous. It's a mixture of eye-wateringly spicy food mixed with mouth-wateringly sweet stuff. They all come together. All the dishes come together. So you can compare and contrast. And in that state, I come from the town of Jodhpur. There are many water bodies in that town. and they are all adorned by architectural masterpieces from the olden age and the medieval age. It's all made up of Jodhpur stone, a yellow stone, but carved as if it was in marble. And just like St. Paul's or Chard or Gherkin evokes nostalgia amongst us Londoners when we are abroad, so does the Mehrangarh Fort evokes nostalgia amongst expat Jodhpurites. It's a small fort on a small hillock only 100 meters high, but it has never been taken in siege. It's got impregnable walls. And if you were to climb up on top of this fort, you will see why the city's got another name. It's always sunny in Jodhpur, whether it is 50 degrees Celsius in April or May, or 0 degrees Celsius in January. And the houses are painted with indigo-hued whitewash. There are many reasons why it might be so, but I think it's to repel the mosquitoes. And Jodhpur gave the world a lot of things, and this is something which you will recognize. Polo played with passion in Jodhpur amongst the nobility, and here in the traditional orange color of the Jodhpur dream. And of course, the eponymous trousers and the boots come from Jodhpur. And Jodhpur also gave the world the grand wedding. Here, this weddings go on for a week altogether, lunches and dinners, in grand set stages with thousands of guests, literally thousands of guests, and hundreds of dishes. The bride and groom are always bedecked in the finest jewelry, diamonds and gold. And if you are unable to visit this land, I would recommend reading. The classic is, of course, James Todd's Annals and Antiquities of Rajasthan. And now it is available in a reprint introduced by Jayvant Paul. Jodhpur is a big state, but it's sparsely populated. Sadly, in the federal state of India, where every state has to fend for itself, because Rajasthan does not have the resources, does not have water, does not have electricity, its development is poor. That always surprises me, because the people are very creative. There's a lot of art. People are very business-minded. And just to give you an example, Lakshmi Mittal of Mittal Arcelor or Anshu Jain of Deutsche Bank are just two examples. There are many such examples in India. Now, here's something for you. You have to guess what my age is and which one I am, and especially in this picture. But I have lots of thanks to give to a number of people. I spent a very nice childhood in Jodhpur. Carefree days. We slept under the sky, a blanket of stars, on the terraces, because there was no electricity, no air conditioning. So you slept outdoors on top of your houses. And in winter, of course, under thick blankets. We were very happy with just a bat and ball playing in the fields. Did you guess me? Well, just like all people from Rajasthan like to migrate, my parents also decided to migrate to a place where they could bring up their children and give them a good education. And like most people in India, they migrate to Bombay. It's the national melting point, just like London is the international melting pot. And when you get out of the plane in Bombay, you're struck with the humidity. I come from Rajasthan, 0% humidity. In Bombay, it's 98% humidity. That just saps your strength. And of course, it is crowded. There's a lot of pollution. You can get about in the local train. You see the crowd there, you will feel happy when you go home today. It's an art form getting in and out of these local trains. You have to plan this two stops before you need to get out. So Bombay has a lot of characteristics, and it's the most densely populated metropolis in the world. But you can see why people come to Bombay. It is the window to the Western world or the developed world. The development there is immense. water, electricity is guaranteed, education is good, jobs are good. And when I was doing this table, I was surprised that England is more densely populated than India. I did not expect that when I was doing these figures. Bombay is also a strange city. It's a city of contrasts. The rich and poor live next to each other. The middle class usually live in the skyscrapers, the rich in enclaves like this, and the poor in hutments or shanty towns, which are all around Bombay. Well, if you can't go to Bombay, I would recommend these two books. Shantaram, written by an Australian convict who gets mixed up with the Bombay underworld and soon to be a Hollywood blockbuster. And Maximum City, a journalistic masterpiece by a New York-based journalist who rediscovered Bombay, the land of his forefathers, by staying for 2 years over there. And of course, Bombay is famous for Bollywood. It's all over Bombay. You can see sets being propped up at every street corner. And there are, of course, lots of famous studios over there. There are posters all over the city. And of course, there are various features in that picture, like the ambassador car from the 1950s. The BEST bus reminds you of the London bus. And of course, the hand-drawn cards. And of course, Bollywood was brought to us by Danny Boyle, a slumdog millionaire. It had the masala of Bollywood, but also based on very harsh reality, which Bombay is. I'll come back to Slumdog Millionaire in a few minutes. But it was a great time to spend my primary school and secondary school years. We all lived in apartments mixed with people who spoke totally different languages, and we learned to play with the kids who spoke totally different languages. This was our family vehicle, my father's favorite Lambretta. All five of us could board on that. It cut through the Bombay traffic. Unfortunately, he died in a road traffic accident riding his Lambretta scooter. As me and my mother were in the accident and emergency department absorbing this news, he didn't know what to do next. So I asked my mom, what next? She didn't know what to do next. After some time, she said, well, what's happened has happened. We can't do anything about it. You have to make your father's dream come true, and you have to become the first doctor in the family. And I hope wherever my father is, that he's proud of today. As I started my medical school, we wanted to make sure that I was well provided for, and benefactors came from various parts of Bombay, unknown benefactors who provided me with scholarship. And I went to the best medical school in Bombay, the third best in the country. You have to beat 600 other kids to get into this medical school. And I could never understand this motto of the medical school because it was intensely competitive, everyone for themselves. I learned more about it when I went into surgical residency. But I had to compete because that was my sustenance, and I had to get the scholarships which I so desperately needed. And then I met a girl. She's a total opposite of whatever I am. She's bright, she's beautiful. She's rich with royal blood in her. She's forthright, she's blunt to the point. It has been a good journey together. And then I got into my much coveted surgical residency. And when you look at this Bombay Working Time Directive, you wonder why it is so coveted. You were given a room which you had to share with two or three other people. You didn't use the room very much. You were always on call for your patients, about 40 or 50 of them. You very quickly realized that sleep is more important than food. and that 4 hours of uninterrupted sleep is much better than 6 or 8 hours of interrupted sleep. Sleep deprivation was common, and weight loss was rampant amongst the residents. But we learned a lot. We saw thousands of patients. We operated on hundreds of patients. We learned also to make sure that we cooperated well with the nurses and the ward boys, to make sure that our 4 hours of uninterrupted sleep was that. We made sure that our work was done in time, and we rose early to make sure that the patients were well looked after. And these are the official beds of the hospital. But the poor were never turned away for lack of beds. Mattresses were put on floor. You just admitted patients if they needed to. This is the outpatient department. You never turned the poor person away because they did not have an appointment. If they came before 10 o'clock, they will get to see a doctor. So I think I'm in the right position to compare the hospital where I learned medicine and the hospital where I teach medicine. Roughly comparable in terms of beds, admissions, outpatients, and operations done. You will notice that only half the number of A&E admissions, and there might be many reasons for it. The slow-moving Bombay traffic never produced high-impact collisions. And if you had a minor condition, you were told to turn up next day in the outpatient department. The number of babies born is also far less, because babies are mostly born in the private sector. They're precious. They're not born in the general teaching hospital. And you can see it was threadbare budget. There was no money or time for research. I did some. I was interested in doing research, but I could not do that. We were too busy playing Robin Hood for our patients. Bombay got scarred during my residency. That scar I still bear, and many of us in the audience would bear that scar. We still don't understand why it became intolerant. It was a very tolerant city. It still is a very tolerant city. We were, of course, protected. We were in the sanctuary of our hospitals, barricaded by the police and the army. And they brought in bodies after bodies, patients after patients. The senior doctors could not get into the hospital, so it was just the resident medical officers fending the patients. And we learned to organize ourselves. The medics looked after the wards, and the surgeons took over the A&E and the operating theater, and we operated nonstop. And luckily for us, the sterilization department for the instruments was not outsourced. It was in the hospital, so we could keep going. But there were good things. I had good mentors, Dilip Karnad, Avinash Chupe, and Ravindra Babat. I had lots of good friends in residency. And we had a good time going, walking or trekking on the Western Ghats. And of course, there was always cricket. And if you watched cricket on those 1.5 days where these two 14 and 15-year-old boys made record, which still stands today, you would have thought Vinod Kambli was the superstar for tomorrow. But 30 years on, we have not heard of this chap. Strange are the twists of fate. But cricket was everywhere. I needed to go somewhere, and USA would have been the wrong place. I would have missed my third slip and gully, the in-swinger and the out-swinger. England was the perfect place. And Irving Benjamin, he's there in the audience, bench. He hosted me. I did my exams. Unfortunately, there was no job at King's College. So I had to apply for jobs, and I applied, and I applied. I was lucky, I got 2 interviews. One interview was for a registrar post. That's a post just below the consultant. And I went for that. And I was told at 26, I was too young to become a registrar. I should come back in a couple of years' time. The next interview I went was for an SHO post. And they saw my logbook, hundreds of operations, and they said, too experienced to be a SHO. I had to go to a locum agency. I got my locum jobs. I got married in Torquay. And People quickly realize you're experienced, you're hardworking, and you get your registrar training numbers. And I was lucky to do research under supervision of Irving Benjamin and Bruce Henry, both in the audience today. It was a good time to do HPV surgery training also. I was given a lot of responsibility, and I enjoyed that very much. And the European Working Time Directive was very, very good. I did not have this much time before in my life. I put that to good use. Whilst my MD research was on cell biology, I took the opportunity to engage with statisticians, epidemiologists, surgeons, and I was given that latitude by Bruce and Benj to publish, to write. That was a very productive period, and I thoroughly enjoyed myself. I wanted to do both surgery and science in my future career. But first of all, thanks. During those period, there were lots of people who helped me. And of course, as I was learning medicine again in England, I became the ambassador for British medicine. A lot of societies and royal colleges entrusted me with funds to go and visit American and European institutions, all not listed over here. And seeing those institutions, I was convinced I wanted to combine surgery and science. I wanted to study stroma, and stroma particularly for pancreatic cancer. And luckily for me, the NIHR Clinician Scientist Award were being issued. So I applied for it, and Bruce helped me write my grant from King's. I went for the interview, and I didn't get it. Door shut. I didn't know what to do next. A few months later, the NIHR officers called me and said, "You want to do pancreas cancer research? Go and meet the leading scientists in the country." They made an appointment for me to go and meet Nick. And when I met Nick, I said, "I actually want to do stroma research in pancreas cancer." And this is what Nick did, and he still does now. He put me in touch with the right person, and put me in touch with Ian. And Ian has also come from his retirement. Thank you, Ian, for coming. Ian was the foremost scientist, and is, I think, still the foremost scientist working on stroma in cancers. He had already assembled a star array of scientists in his laboratory. He took a punt, he took a surgeon on. And this scientist taught the surgeon that DNA, which us clinicians would use routinely as did not attend, was not the right meaning. I, in turn, cajoled this excellent scientist to think and apply the superb abilities for clinical applications. It was mutually beneficial. So here I was. I was able to combine surgery and science. Hammersmith and CityLine became my lifeline. So Barts Cancer Institute was just being formed, and now it is amongst the top 10 cancer institutes in the world. State-of-the-art facilities at Charterhouse Square. And the Royal London Hospital, the oldest teaching school in England, was being revamped, and now we have the state-of-the-art facilities, both for the patients and in the operating theater. This was the best place to be in. You will also notice that Royal London Hospital has got a helicopter pad facilities. This is the only hospital which can land a helicopter within M25. So emergency surgery is trying. And within 2 months of my appointment as a consultant surgeon, you'll remember this date, you'll be remembering this in 2 months' time, I was on call. But it was a good place to be on call because all my colleagues were there within a couple of hours. And within 4 hours, we had treated more than 200 victims of the sad bomb blast. And we have been looking as to how to improve the flow of patients in our emergency department, how to get them to theater early. It is one of the busiest A&E departments in the country. But most of what I do is HPV surgery, operating on organs, liver, the bile duct, gallbladder, and pancreas, operating mainly on the cancer of those organs. Here is a thermometer chart of the 5-year survival rate for all cancers is about 66%, and there are good cancers, prostate, melanoma, breast cancer. And there are bad cancers. The 5-year survival rate for liver and pancreatic cancers is the lowest. And why is that? I'm not allowed to show operative pictures, and therefore there are pictures from the web over here. It is because the liver and the pancreas are very deep-seated organs, encased within the rib cage and amongst other abdominal organs. And if you want to operate on them, you have to understand the anatomy very clearly. You have to understand how the blood flows out of the liver and into the liver. And here's a typical CT scan, which we see in our MDT meeting, which will make us decide whether we want to do a right lobectomy or a left lobectomy or one of the other operations. So when you're doing the operation, once you have uncovered the liver, you have to make a big incision, first of all. And once you have uncovered the liver, you come to the hilum of the liver. It has the fresh blood from the heart, oxygenated blood from the hepatic artery, and the digested food in the portal vein coming from the gut. And it also has the bile duct, which gets all the excretion from the liver into the bowel. So if you wanted to do a right hepatectomy, you would be carefully dividing the blood vessels and the bile duct for the right side and leaving the structures for the left side intact. And then you would divide the liver. But before you do that, you need to divide the blood supply out of the liver. And then finally, you would have this kind of picture where only the left lobe of the liver is left behind. And you would be surprised that we can leave as little as 30% of the liver behind, and it will grow back to about 100% of the liver within about 6 weeks. It is the only organ which can regenerate at such rapid pace. We have been doing innovative surgery. We've been doing keyhole surgery to not only remove the tumors in the bowel, but also the tumors from the bowel which have spread to the liver. And Dennis, one of my patients, went to the national press and has advocated the use of keyhole surgery, which reduced the hospital stay from 30 days to 4 days. We have been conducting research and learning how to identify high-risk populations, how to conduct surgery better, how to be vigilant for gallbladder surgery and perform early surgery, and devise better treatment algorithms for our patients. In doing so, we interact with surgeons and gastroenterologists from various specialties. And we do this to have better surgical outcome and better overall outcome for our patients. I also do pancreas surgery. And here is a diagram of pancreas to show how the pancreatic duct opens along with the bile duct into the bowel called duodenum. It is surrounded by vital blood vessels. These are important to our life. We cannot sacrifice those blood vessels. And therefore, if you were to do surgery for the head of the pancreas for a tumor here, then you would have to transect the bile duct somewhere here, the stomach somewhere here, and the bowel somewhere here, the pancreas here, all the time preserving these vital blood vessels. So this is what it would look like. Not only the tumor comes out, but a lot of normal organs have to come out because of the intricate interaction between these organs. And then we have to restore the continuity so that the pancreatic juice, the bile juice, can flow and mix with the food. All these joints are delicate joints, and if any of these leaks, then the patient can be in for a long time. So this is how we would set up in the operating theater. These are two of the junior doctors in our team with a scrub nurse, surrounded by a load of gizmos or instruments, the ultrasound machine, the device to cut tissues, the diathermy machine. You will notice the theater is Spartan. The most important thing is the surgical safety checklist. And the person who guides us through all this is the anesthetist. He's surrounded by an array of monitors feeding him information from the patient through various lines, tubes, giving him the important information about how safe the patient is. Of course, it's a very invasive procedure, and the patients who are usually in their 70s and 80s become very vulnerable. They're kept in intensive care for 24 to 48 hours. They take about 2 weeks to recover in the hospital and up to 2 months to recover at home. And we have been looking at how to do pancreatic surgery better. We have been trying to detect complications. We've been devising better methods of palliation. We've been doing research into how to conduct the surgery. We think that doing the very big operation is better than doing the very, very, very big operation. And this helps the patient recover faster, and they can go for adjuvant chemotherapy. And of course, the more we do, the better we get. And we have led the UK duodenal cancer study group and also looked into the pancreatic duodenectomy outcomes. We provide a tertiary referral service to a number of hospitals in the southeast of England. And in doing so, we train a lot of surgeons. These surgeons are already trained consultant surgeons when they come to us, and they're trained in HPV surgery. And they go on to become consultants in their respective country, thus enhancing our international reputation. And of course, surgeons take all the limelight, but there are lots of people involved. And the most important people are the nursing team. I cannot put all their names over here. And I'm embarrassed to say that I know them only by their first names. But they provide the 24/7 cover for our patients. They look after our patients. Most of them are women, and shifts overrun, childcare problems are there, but they are there for the patients. They are corralled by our CNS, the clinical nurse specialist. I've already talked about a lot of specialties over here. Let me talk about interventional radiology and oncology. These are the specialties who deal with those patients whom the surgeons cannot deal with. And of course, the pathologist. They have the final say. They perform the microscopic examination of our surgical performance. They tell us whether the cancer has been removed or not. And they would show us pictures like this. This is pancreas cancer under the microscope. There are a lot of cancer cells here, but there are a lot of non-cancer cells over here also. So if you were to pick up each and every cancer cell and overlay it with red, this is what you would see. The number of cancer cells or the area occupied by cancer cells is very little. The rest of it is normal tissue. It's not normal, it's scar tissue, desmoplasia or stroma. Now, we don't know whether this stroma is there to protect the body, to prevent the cancer from spreading, or it is there so that the cancer is protected from the immune attack from the host. This is what we wanted to study. And if you want to study this, you have to understand the seed and soil hypothesis, first proposed by Stephen Paget at St. Bart's Hospital. In the 1880s, when he was observing breast cancer patients, he understood that these patients have predominantly metastasis or spread of cancer to the bone, the lung, or the liver. And he thought that maybe these organs have the right soil in which the circulating seed can implant and grow. Of course, he had no experimental proof for this. This was provided by Ian Hart, working in Josh Fidler's lab. He was studying melanoma. Based on these observations on breast cancer and melanoma patients, these were proposed as the first milestone in understanding how cancer grows and spreads. I think it would be entirely appropriate to understand the seed and soil hypothesis with the example of garden. This beautiful garden is just like your health. You have to tend to it. You have to make sure that it remains healthy. And this has a lot of parallels in socioeconomic aspects, but also in terms of medicine and in terms of cell biology. So we urban folk have a lot of resources. We get the gardeners in, so we get our personal trainers in to look after our health. But we can get diseases, and diseases are like weeds. Some diseases are easy to eradicate, but cancer is that nasty weed which does not go away. It grows and it spreads. And the spores of these weeds could be like the epithelial mesenchymal transition. this cancer grows because of the soil is right in that garden. And you can draw parallels about treatment of cancer with gardening also. So the mechanical deep feeding is like surgery. Direct, precise, and it sets the garden back quite a bit, but then it recovers. It is useful if the weed is localized. It's not useful if the weed is far spread into the garden. The spores are there everywhere. Then you need chemical de-weeding or chemotherapy. So the seed of soil hypothesis was first proposed to understand metastasis, but now it can be used to understand the cancer microenvironment. We should perhaps call it the weed and soil hypothesis. So we have been studying this in our laboratories, and we've been using the organotypic model to study this. Now, organotypic models have been used by Louise for breast cancer and by John for skin cancer in our laboratories already. We did changes in that organotypic model to reflect what is unique about pancreas cancer. We provided it with the pancreatic stellate cells. We provided it with the right extracellular matrix components to mimic pancreas cancer. And these models have lots of advantages. They're cost effective, they're reproducible, they're exportable. About 40 labs worldwide use our organotypic models. They have multiple readouts. They reduce the animal experiments, and you can do preclinical trials. But you cannot really mimic what happens in vivo, and we are trying to do that by introducing endothelial cells and immune cells. And we have learned a lot from organotypic culture. So this cartoon will try and explain this. So these are epithelial cells, the normal cells, arranged in a line like the army, resting on a basement membrane, which is sitting on top of some extracellular matrix. And they are arranged in this manner because there is E-cadherin, which keeps the cells together, which is linked to beta-catenin. These are molecules which help the cells stay in an orderly manner. And the cell's top end is defined by eserin. Now, if you were to add pancreatic stellate cells into this mix, they would multiply, they would lay down the extracellular matrix, they would break down the basement membrane, and now this army becomes an unruly mob. And there are a lot of changes. The beta-catenin is now no longer at the cell-cell junction. It's all over in the cell. And the eserin, which was at the top of the cell, is at the bottom of the cells, allowing the cancer cells to invade and migrate. There's loss of E-cadherin. We use these organotypic models and other tools in our laboratory to study not only the cancer, but the soil. And we have published a lot on that, looking at the interaction not only between the cancer and the fibrous tissue, but within the stroma, between different components of the stroma, the immune cells, and the blood vessels. There's not enough time for me to tell you about all these interactions, but I'll try and explain this with the help of this simple cartoon. So this is representative of the basic unit of the pancreas, the acinus, which produces the pancreatic juices which are required for digestion. And there are millions of acini in the pancreas. They all open into the duct. And the pancreas ductal adenocarcinoma may arise either from the acinus or the duct. We are not quite sure yet. These structures are supported by stellate cells. These are unique cells to the pancreas and the liver. In you and me, they would be storing vitamin A. That's their chief function. But we also know that there are other things, such as the blood vessels. And these cells, we know from knowledge in developmental biology and regenerative biology, that they talk to each other. And they talk to each other using a range of signaling cascades and signaling molecules. What's more important is not the signaling cascade or molecule, but the flux, the level of that signal. And that can change very rapidly in embryogenesis and in regeneration. Now, this is a depiction of cancer. They're unruly cells, not ordered in a particular way, and they're rapidly dividing. They recruit these pancreatic stellate cells and make them into activated myofibroblasts. These are the henchmen for the cancer. They rapidly divide. They lay down tracks. They lay down the extracellular matrix, along which the cancer cells invade, migrate. They also do other things. They prevent the immune cells, which would have killed the cancer otherwise, the cytotoxic T cells, from coming close to the cancer. So the stellate cells form a fortress around that cancer. Whatever immune cells, such as macrophages, do get in, they're re-educated by the stroma and the cancer to be tumor-associated macrophages. And they push the blood vessels away from the cancer. The blood vessels are small, so pancreas cancer is uniquely a hypovascular cancer in presence of a very hypervascular normal structure. And this is done because the normal crosstalk between cancer and the other cells is hijacked. The flux has changed. And we propose we should alter not only the cancer cell, or target the cancer cell, but also target the stromal cells. Now, I've told you the stellate cells store vitamin A. And the doctors in this audience will say, yes, when a pancreas cancer patient comes in, we treat the pancreas cancer patient with an injection of vitamin K because they're deficient in that vitamin. That's a fat-soluble vitamin. We are particularly careful about vitamin K because otherwise the patient would bleed. We ignore the other vitamin deficiencies. We said we would restore the vitamin A depots in these stellate cells, and we used a specific isoform of vitamin A called all-trans-retinoic acid. And we could see changes. We could see stellate cells, not all of them, but at least some of them, restore their physiological status. They could get their vitamin A depots back in. And this restored the flux between the talk of stellate cells and the cancer cells. All these signaling molecules could be altered. And this is important. We cannot target just a single signaling molecule. We have to alter a range of signaling molecules. And this resulted in change in the behavior of cancer cells. They were much more approachable by the cytotoxic CD8 T cells and chemotherapy agents because of the increase in blood vessels and the tumor-associated macrophages, which were repolarized. So all this is very good. But what about the patient? We went with this data to the Medical Research Council and a big pharmaceutical company, Celgene, and they've awarded us a grant to put this into clinical trial. We'll be testing whether gemcitabine can be safely combined with nab-paclitaxel supplied by Celgene and all-trans-retinoic acid. So we will determine the maximum tolerated dose. We will also determine whether we can restore the vitamin A levels, not only in the blood, but also in the pancreas cancer. And we'll be looking for signal. We'll be looking to see if the cancer can be reduced sufficiently for us surgeons to be able to remove it and impact on the survival of pancreas cancer patients. And we'll be studying this by looking at CT scans, MRI, and biomarkers. Now, biomarkers are very important because then you can detect a cancer, you can follow the patients up. And a lot of patients ask us when we are in the clinic why things have not been done to diagnose the cancer early. Why can you not monitor my cancer and help me and my family? These are questions which us doctors always face. We may have an answer to it soon because Pancreatic Cancer Research Fund has entrusted us to develop a coordinated strategy nationally with all the specialties coming together to provide a tissue resource for the scientists to work with. We'll be involving the patients and the relatives. We'll be involving a high-level organization such as NHS England and Public Health England. With the help of hospitals, universities, we'll provide a bioinformatic and IT core to understand all that data. And we'll be developing better tools and better biomarkers. I've also told you what I do is resect metastasis in the liver. And how cancer spreads is also important. So Barts Cancer Institute wants to do the same thing as we are doing with the Pancreas Cancer Research Fund. So there's a pump priming grant which has been provided to use the resources for the Barts Health NHS Trust, which is the biggest NHS trust in England. We serve about 2.5 million people, and we will be able to monitor how this cancer grows and then spreads in patients by collecting serial samples. So you can see I have a very rich experience, and I interact with a number of people and do a number of things. And this is fascinating, but this is all possible because of number of people working together. First and foremost, my research team members, past and present, who work evenings and weekends, all hours put together, to develop the data which we so require to convince the doctors, the nurses, and the funding bodies, which provide the funds to do the research. And of course, we are very well supported, both at Barts Cancer Institute and QMUL in a wider sense, and the external academia internationally as we develop tissue banking and clinical trials. All this is underpinned with excellent clinical service delivery at Barts Health NHS Trust and our referring hospitals. And of course, in my personal life, there are a lot of people who influenced me, who changed my character. But most important are my close family. Kavita is an internationally acclaimed hemato-oncologist doing innovative bone marrow transplantation. And I don't know how she does it, but she balances that with looking after two inquisitive, highly talented kids who are very demanding. The constant why, but why, when, where, and just trying to answer those questions keeps me on my toes. They also keep me firmly grounded. Thank you.
An astonishing journey and an astonishing range of commitments and contributions in so many domains. You can see why we're so proud that he's chosen to build his career here and why the university recognized him with a professorial chair last year. Now, I'm very glad that Ajit Abraham, who's the clinical director for surgery and cancer, wasn't here to see that job plan from Mumbai, because I know that he's looking to increase our productivity several fold. So keep that to yourself, Hemant. Now, the Barts Cancer Institute has a reputation for the quality of its parties and social occasions, which I suspect might remind you of those Jodhpur wedding ceremonies that go on for a week. And we'd like to invite you to a reception in the Shield, which is just across the square, to help Hemant celebrate this special day. Thank you.